My dear student friends, in today's lecture, let's study the microsporidian diseases of silkworms. Microsporidiosis or pebrine is a contagious, chronic and insidious disease in silkworm. It is the earliest known menace to the silk industry. The disease is known for its devastating effect by being transmitted transovarially to the host progeny. The first record of the occurrence of the disease comes from France in 1845. The annual production of cocoons, which amounted to 26 tons in 1853, has come down to 4,000 tons in 1865 in France due to the epizootics of pebrine. Later, the disease spread to Italy, Spain, Syria and Romania. The damage caused by the disease in Europe was devastating and the cocoon production declined sharply. The French government appointed Louis Pasteur to probe the disease and suggest remedial measures to contain the disease. He made extensive study of the disease and established that the disease is caused by a pathogen. The disease is transmitted by way of egg, ingestion of contaminated food and by contact with the diseased silkworms. He also developed a practical method which is being in practice even today. He suggested the screening out infected eggs by mother mouth examination and supply only the healthy silkworm eggs laid by uninfected moths. This approach has saved the sericulture industry all over the world. D. Quadrifagus in 1860 named the disease pebrine due to pepper-like spores exhibited by the diseased larvae in advanced stage of infection. But this peppery appearance is not common in tropical regions. In India, the first report of occurrence of this disease was in 1866 from Mysore. There was an epidemic level outbreak of the disease in Kashmir in 1878. In Mysore and Madras provinces during 1890 to 1900, there was an outbreak of this disease. The prevalence of the disease in India was about 15% in 1983 and declined gradually by 1984 and 1985. Again, the pebrine incidence reached the peak during 1991-1992 period. The epidemic in India caused a loss of over 200 crores during the period. By adopting intensive management strategies, the menace was contained and now the disease is under control. Apart from Nosema bombaisis, many other microsporidia also cause the disease in silkworms. Since there is no complete cure for this disease, various disease management strategies are adopted to contain this menace. For better appreciation, the topic is being explained into different subheadings and they are causative organism and its systematic position, diversity of microsporidia, symptoms of the disease, infection and disease occurrence, prevention of the disease and contamination, management of pebrine disease. Let us see the first one. Causative organisms and its systematic position. Microsporidians in the past were placed under the phyla Protozoa. However, recently the taxonomy of Microsporidia has undergone drastic revision. The uniqueness of these microsporidia has made many taxonomies to elevate these eukaryotic organisms to the level of a phylum. At present, most microsporidiologists follow the system proposed by Sprague. The microsporin causing pebrine disease in silkworms belong to the phylum Microspora, class Microsporia, order Microsporida, suborder Apansporoblastina, family Nosematidae, genus Nosema, species Bombaisis. The members of class Microsporia in the phylum Microspora are commonly called Microsporidia. The disease they cause is called microsporidiosis. Microsporidia rank among the smallest of eukaryotes and have an intracellular habit. They possess unicellular spores containing a uninucleate or binucleate sporoplasm. They have an extrusion apparatus with a polar filament and a polar cap. The polar filament is elastic, stretching to 3 times the length of the coiled state when extended from the spore. The coils of the filament are frequently seen in electron micrographs as a series of cross-section lying in rows. The number of coils is characteristic to a particular microsporidian species or strain which was considered for characterization of a spore. But presently, serological and molecular techniques are employed to differentiate and characterize different microsporidian spores. They do not have mitochondria. Their life cycle stages are ultrastructurally unique and distinct from other spore-forming protozoa. Even though they are eukaryotic microorganisms, their ribosomal RNAs have prokaryotic properties and had separated very early from other eukaryotes. The spores tied over the adverse environmental conditions with a resilient spore wall that consists of a proteinaceous exospore and chitinous endospore. The infection with microsporidia of the genus Nosema is termed as nosemosis. The spores of Nosema bombyensis measures 3.8 micrometers in length and 2.6 micrometers in width. The spores are highly refractile, oval or ovo-cylindrical in shape and exhibit characteristic Brownian movements. The second aspect of our study is diversity of microsporidia. Apart from Nosema bombyensis, many other microsporidians also is found to cause microsporidiosis in silkworms. The most common ones are Nosema species NIS-001, NIS-M11, NIS-M14, NIK-2R and NIK-3H. Some microsporidians belonging to Viremorpha species NIS-M12 and NIK-4M are found infective to silkworms. Some species of microsporidia belong to Pleistophora, Thelonia, Microsporidium and Leptomonas also are infective to silkworms. These microsporidians differ in their spore morphology, targeted tissues and virulence. Some of them are non-virulent and some others are not transmitted transovirally. The incubation period of these microsporidians vary considerably in the silkworms. Symptoms of the disease forms the third aspect of our study. The symptoms of puberin vary depending on the stage of silkworm, that is, egg, larva, pupa and moth infected with puberin show distinctive symptoms, which form important criteria for identifying the disease. Egg. As per the process of transoviral transmission, the pathogen parasitizes the ovary of the female moth. In such infected moths, the pathogen moves into the eggs and after deposition of the eggs, it undergoes multiplication and disease development takes place in the embryos. When the degree of infection of egg is relatively high, the egg often becomes unfertilized or dead. But when the contamination is at a lower scale, the egg hatches and the disease develops at larval stage. Lack of uniformity in the egg shape, reduction in egg size and weight, eggs laid in clumps are the symptoms. The infected moth may lay few eggs and do not glue to the substrata well. This is due to the lack of production of gluing substance by the accessory glands. Many eggs laid by the infected moths will be either dead or unfertilized. Larva. First instar larvae infected embryonically show no spacing of body hairs, that is no growth. 2 days after hatching, the larvae become darker, thin and exhibit slow growth. If infection takes place at the beginning of first instar, similar symptoms are observed. Infection at the later stages, the diseased silkworms appear comparatively paler and translucent. The detection of the disease by external appearance is difficult initially, and as the disease advances in larvae, the symptoms are manifested. At times, incomplete molting, difficulty in molting, and delayed molting are also could be observed among infected larvae. They may show wrinkled skin with a rustic brown color of the body, especially on the caudal horn and lateral to the prolux. In some cases, distinct small and large black spots appear in the skin due to melanosis. The larvae lose appetite, show retarded growth, sometimes vomit gut juice, shrink in size, and become undersized. They also become flaccid, and the faces will have higher moisture content. Unequal size of the worms in the colony is a striking symptom of puberine infection. The affected gut becomes opaque, and the silk gland shows white pustules or spots in different places along its length. Pupa. Cocoons spun by puberinized infected larvae may become flimsy and malformed. Diseased pupa becomes lusterless and relatively less reactive to tactile stimulus. The abdomen softens, and irregular black spots appear on the body. Highly infected pupae may fail to metamorphose into adults. Moth. Delayed moth emergence, complete inability to emerge and inability to eclose through pupal skin after wing development are some of the symptoms in the infected moths. Sick moths may develop clubbed wings. Developed wings not spreading, moths not showing mating interest, discoloration of abdominal scales, shedding of scales from body and wings are also observed. In puberinized female moths, the accessory glands being infected results in laying loosely adhered eggs which easily fall off from egg cards. However, the spore stage of the pathogen may be seen under microscope in the homogenate of different stages of host or feces of infected larvae. The fourth aspect of our study is infection and disease occurrence. The infection of the pathogen occurs through two routes, namely the oral and ovarian. Pathogenic entry by the oral portal results in horizontal transmission, and by the ovarian portal in vertical transmission. The former is the primary route in which infection takes place by ingestion of the spores along with the contaminated mulberry leaf. The spores germinate under alkaline conditions inside the gut of the host larva and infect the epithelial cells. The infective agent or the sporoplasm, after entering a target epithelial cell, grows and forms a schison. The schisons divide repeatedly to form several daughter schisons. They then transform into sporons, which later develop into sporoblasts. The sporoblasts develop into spores. Nosema bombaicis, during its life cycle, produces two types of spores, a smaller pear-shaped short-coiled type of spore and a typically oval, refractile, long-coiled type of spore. The latter type of spores can be easily distinguished under a normal bright field microscope at a magnification of 600x, and this method of diagnosis at seed production level helps in managing the disease. Infection occurring through ovarial route can be detected during the early larval stages itself. Monitoring of this disease during the progress of a silkworm crop is extremely important to facilitate destruction of the infected crop at a proper time. It is also helpful to avoid any scope for contamination and spread of the disease in the field. The fifth aspect of our study highlights the prevalence of the disease and contamination. The survival of the Nosema bombaicis in the environment and seasonal incidence of puberin are influenced by several factors. In tropical countries like India, Febrile is more prevalent in the rainy and cooler season. This could be due to the intensive sericulture activity during these seasons. It could also be due to higher rate of survival of the spores in the field due to the congenial conditions during these seasons. Survival of spores also depends on the kind of material in which they are found, in addition to the moisture content of the material. Some of the primary factors involved in the disease initiation and development include the pathogen number, host population, and an efficient means of transmission. So let us focus on the source of contamination. Transovirally infested seed is the primary source of contamination in the field. Contaminated drying room, appliances, and silkworm litter also contribute to the spread of the disease. Studies reveal that a single infected larva in a population of 200 larvae could bring about 40% of infection in the moth stage. Some other lepidopteran pests which harbor the microsporidium is also a major source of contamination. The excreta or scales of such carrier insects which contaminates the mulberry leaf in the garden could bring in microsporidiosis in a silkworm colony. Similar to source of contamination, stages of contamination also is a vital aspect to be understood. Contamination of pebrine occurs during any time in the larval stages. Low infection of the pathogen in the mother moth tends to pass unnoticed in one generation and generally build up over subsequent generations, contaminating the rearing environment. The disease may pass unnoticed due to the partial infection of eggs. The death of infected larvae during early instars may also escape detection. The larvae hatched from transovirally infected layings exhibit irregular growth and die in the rearing bed before third molt. When healthy larvae are reared with the infected larvae, secondary contamination takes place perorally. The larvae perorally infected during first and second instar show symptoms in the fourth or fifth instars and die before spinning. If the contamination takes place in the third instar, the larvae show symptoms in the fifth instar and die on the mount edges before cocooning. These larvae discharge spores through the fecal matter during fourth and fifth instars. When the healthy larvae in the infected bed consumes these spores along with the mulberry leaf during 4th and 5th instars, they get infected. The larvae infected on this manner spin normal cocoons and undergo eclosion but deposit transovirally infected eggs. Secondary contamination takes place usually from rearing rooms, appliances, mulberry garden, and surface contaminated layers. In the rearing bed, contamination takes place through the fecal matter voided by infected larvae. Contaminated tray or bed, seed paper, dust, and larvae dead due to the disease. Improper and careless disposal of silkworm litter and infected larvae and use of incompletely decomposed silkworm bed refuse in the mulberry fields may form potential source of contamination. Surface contamination of eggs lead to transovum transmission of the disease. Also, if the layings are incubated in a contaminated room without proper disinfection, it could lead to surface contamination of eggs. The larvae during the course of hatching bite the chorion, resulting in infection. The moth scales and urine are also other possible sources of surface contamination. The final subject matter in our study today is the management of pebrine disease. Louis Pasteur is credited to have played a monumental role of rescuing sericulture industry from the devastating disease. He established that a pathogen causes the disease and that the pathogen is transmitted by way of eggs and by ingestion of contaminated food. He developed a practical method by which it was able to initiate new uninfected colonies from moths, ovipositioned for moth laying after conducting moth examination. The basic requirement in management of pebrine disease in silkworms is the disease diagnosis. The symptoms of the disease are atypical, and the formation of characteristic spores alone is the most reliable diagnostic feature. The spores of Nosema bombyensis could be observed in the homogenate of the infected eggs, larvae, pupae and moths, apart from the feces of infected larvae. The spores can be observed from the dust samples of silkworm rearing rooms and scales collected from egg production centers. An integrated approach is the most appropriate management strategy for Pebrine disease. It involves a strict inspection system during production of parent seed, strict disinfection and hygiene in silkworm rearings, and the centrifugal method of mother moth examination during the process of commercial silkworm seed production. Monitoring of Pebrine disease should be done at every stage of a silkworm crop, right from the incubation of silkworm eggs. Let us see the different stages one by one. Monitoring in the egg stage. Samples of the eggs are judiciously selected from batch by observing the external morphological anomalies. Microscopic examination should be carried out by following standard egg testing procedures. The sample eggs are crushed using a mortar and pestle by adding a small quantity of 0.5% K2CO3 solution. The crushed homogenate is filtered through 2 to 3 layers of muslin cloth. The filtrate is centrifuged at 3000 rpm for 3 minutes. The supernatant is discarded and the sediment is dispersed in a few drops of 0.5% K2CO3 or clean water in a cyclomixture. A small smear is placed on a clean slide and examined under a microscope at 600x. Examination of the larvae. The larvae in all instars should be examined. Young instar larvae are examined visually, and those suspected to be diseased are selected for microscopic examination. The larvae are thoroughly macerated in 0.6% K2CO3 solution by using a mortar and pestle at 1:4 ratio. The homogenate is processed as described earlier by following the standard procedures and examined. Examination of pupae. The examination of pupae is important in the context of a possible late age infection. This would also help destruction of the cocoon lot well before emergence and seed production operation. This could prevents the extensive contamination in seed production centers. 10 pupae are homogenized by adding 90 ml of 0.6% potassium carbonate solution. The procedure of examination is the same as described earlier. Examination of silkworm litter and dust samples. About 1 to 2 gram of litter is soaked and macerated in about 8 to 10 times volume of 0.6% potassium carbonate solution. A few drops of 1N HCl is added, mixed, filtered, centrifuged, and the sediment is examined. Similar practice can be adopted for testing of dust samples too. Examination of moths. Incidence of Pebrine disease in silkworm crops can be best prevented by following systematic mother moth examination procedure at the seed production centers. In the commercial grainages, a system of mass moth examination is followed. For this, homogenate 20 moths in a domestic mixie by adding 80 to 100 ml of 0.6% potassium carbonate solution. The homogenate is poured into a clean beaker and allowed to stand for 3 to 5 minutes. The clean liquid at the bottom is slowly filtered through 2 to 3 layers of muslin cloth. The filtrate is centrifuged at 3000 rpm for 3 minutes. The supernatant is discarded and the sediment is dispersed in a few drops of 0.6% K2CO3 solution. The dispersed sediment is examined under a microscope at 600x. But individual moth examination is best suited and advocated for basic seed production. 100% of seed produced should be subjected to examination. Any lot or batch revealed Pebrine incidence should not be used for seed multiplication. An improved procedure of delayed mother mouth test has been advocated for more accurate detection of the disease. This time delay enhances the sporulation in the body of the moths, thus enhancing the chances of detection. Measures for prevention of pebrine at farmers level. Constant monitoring of the farmers' crops for pebrine disease is very important. This will help in deal with the episodicity of this disease. Many critical measures are required to deal with this disease at farmers' level. Proper education of farmers about the nature, transmission, and consequences of pebrine disease is very important. Proper disinfection of equipments, rearing house, and premises with recommended disinfectant is a must. Rearing of pebrine-free seed, use of effective bed disinfectant, strict observance of rearing and personal hygiene, proper disposal of bed refuse, litter, and dead larvae, inspection of larvae by standard procedure, immediate destruction of infected crops as soon as infection is noticed, control of mulberry and other agricultural pests to avoid chances of cross infection, synchronization of crops for easy monitoring, and adoption of preventive measures, etc., are the measures to be adopted as part of integrated pebrine disease management. Thus, the topic can be summarized that the pebrine disease in silkworms is caused by microsporidian spores. There are different microsporidian species and strains infecting silkworms. The pebrine disease in silkworms causes specific symptoms in every stage of silkworm life cycle. The infection of the pathogen occurs through two routes, namely the oral and ovarial. Pathogenic entry by the oral portal results in horizontal transmission and by the ovarial portal in vertical transmission. The survival of Nosema bombyensis in the environment and seasonal incidence of pebrine are influenced by several factors. The basic requirement in management of pebrine disease in silkworms is the disease diagnosis. An integrated approach is the most appropriate management strategy for pebrine disease. It involves a strict inspection system during production of parent seed, strict disinfection and hygiene in silkworm rearings, and centrifugal method of mother mouth examination during the process of commercial silkworm seed production. Thank you.